Blog Talk Radio.
This land is mine. God gave this land to me. This brave and ancient land to me. And when the morning sun reveals her hills and plains, then I see a land where children can run free. So take my hand and walk this land with me, and walk this lovely land with me. Though I am just a man, when you are by my side, with the help of God, I know I can be.
Well, good evening. Welcome to Yada Yada Radio. I'm here with Kirk this evening. It's our pleasure to be with you this beautiful Shabbat evening. At least it is Shabbat here in the middle of the Caribbean Sea. Sunset for us about an hour ago. Probably still bright and sunny out there in the People's Republic of California, isn't it, Kirk?
That's, yes, a little bit of light left, and it's way up to 41 degrees.
Yeah. You know, I understand this is the real advantage now of living in California, all the way up to 41. That's lovely. It is chilly here tonight. I think it's down to about 77. So that is that's global cooling out this way. You know, it's a real advantage now living in California. You don't need to bring a credit card or cash to any retailer.
It's Nordstrom.
You know, everything is five-finger discount. You just go in and take what you want, and there's no ramifications. So, you know, in fact, I think they give you an award in California if you go in, take what you want, and don't threaten anyone or break up the store in the process. So... it's a lovely place. The libertards have done their thing. I tell you what, I won't be anytime soon that I will be headed to California, Washington, or Oregon State, or any of those communities. I'm told by an avid listener who is admittedly biased, that our last program was worth listening to either three or four times is how often my wife listened to it. So I guess we did an okay job on the last show. We got a really tall order to live up to this time. So let's dig right in. I think we're dealing with good material. Not only is Zechariah a very interesting prophet, but he got the premier job. His entire book is a presentation of Yom Kippurim, and Yom Kippurim is the single favorite day on Yahweh's calendar. His viewpoint, it is the antithesis of a day of affliction. It is a day of great celebration and the reconciliation with Israel, which has been wayward for a very, very long time. Just in case we needed to be have that reaffirmed, we were at the end of our last program in Zechariah, I think, Kirk, and it reads as follows. Yeah, it reads as follows. And I will come to them and bring them. The speaker here is Yahowah. And I will come to them. When was the last time that Yahowah came to his people?
Not for a long time. It's about
3,450 years ago, give or take a jot or a tittle. This is a big deal, and I will come to them, and I will bring them to live and abide in the midst of Yaruwshalaim, the source of guidance on reconciliation and restoration. Boy, that's going to be news to the United Nations. You know, the United Nations voted
so much fun.
A couple of weeks ago, something like, 200 to 19 to designate Yahweh's Temple Mount as a Muslim holy site with no affinity whatsoever to Jews, much less Christians. Somebody ought to tell those buffoons that the only claim that Muslims have to Jerusalem and the Temple Mount is Muhammad's pathetic night's journey, where he was engaged in pedophilia, and he had just spouted out the satanic verses, so he was in a whole world of trouble from a credibility point of view, because in the satanic verses, there are four gods, three goddesses in addition to Allah, occupying the great rock pile of the Kaaba. And so he had been accused of speaking on behalf of Satan. Then he admitted that all of Allah's messengers speak on behalf of Satan, and that he had this issue too with pedophilia, and that he was 53 and his girl toy was 9 years old. And so he needed a credibility boost. And what could be more credible than claiming in the middle of the night while you're sleeping with a nine-year-old girl that a flying ass came to your bed and you jumped aboard the flying ass and you flew from Mecca to Jerusalem to meet with all of the Hebrew big shots in the temple. Well, for a credibility point of view, it's not so good because, well, asses don't fly, and the temple had been destroyed by the Romans in 70 CE, and this was just shy of 700 CE. So he missed his timeline by a smidge.
Missed his boat.
Yeah, just by a smidge. And of course, then he added to his credibility by letting Muslims know that if you want to go to the Islamic heaven, you have to go through Jerusalem. Well, that's not so good for the credibility of the Kaaba, but nonetheless, they don't question that. And then the Temple Mount became a Muslim heritage site because of the hoofy print of the flying ass as it leapt up towards hell en route to heaven. And of course, Muhammad gloriously announces that hell is filled with women who are being hung by meat hooks through their breasts because they didn't fully appreciate the loving generosity of their husbands. And therein is the story. There is no other claim other than Muhammad's flight of fancy. And so they ought to be embarrassed. And anyone who claims that it is a holy site for Islam ought to be shamed. It's, it shows complete ignorance. And, of course, why don't you look at your Rome? If you don't want to look at the Torah and prophets, well, if you don't look at the Torah and prophets, there can't be any Palestinians because they're named after the Philistines. They're only known through the Torah and prophets. So that destroys your entire gig if you don't want to look at the Torah and prophets. But nonetheless, let's just pretend we don't want to look at that. Then why not consider the Romans? And when the Romans were there, what was the province called?
Yahowah.
Yeah, it was
Yahowah.
Was the name of the province. It means Jew. means beloved of Yah. Yehudim is translated as Jews, Yehuda as Jew. And the capital of the province of Yahudah was Yaruwshalaim, which is a Hebrew word meaning the Yaru means the source of teaching and instruction on Shalom, reconciliation flows from this place. So you got a province that's named after the Jews with a city that is named in Hebrew. And on that, in 70 CE, what did the Romans tear down?
They tore down
the temple, which was the Yahowah temple, right? Built by the Jews. So please tell me, even if you like your secular history, your Roman history, how come you can't figure that part out? Are the nations of the world and those that attend the United Nations that universally stupid? Are they anti-Semitic?
Well, they just want to be that way.
Have they turned their religion, their politics into a religion? I suspect some of both.
Yeah.
Anyway, Yahweh says, I will come to them and bring them to live and abide in the midst of Yaruwshalaim, the source of guidance on reconciliation and restoration, which means that since he is speaking to Yisrael, it will be exclusively Yisraelites. There will not be a two-state solution. And they will be my people, becoming my family. And I myself will be their God in honesty and integrity, in truth, reliable and dependable, trustworthy and steadfast, and by being right. So, pretty straightforward. God's returning to live and abide in Yaruwshalaim, in the midst of his people, and he is announcing that for the first time in 3,400 and nearly 50 years that Israelites will be his people, his family, and that he will be considered once again their God, and that their relationship will be approached once again honestly, reliably, truthfully, with Israelites being right for the first time in millennia. Thus says Yahweh, the of the spiritual messengers, Yahweh Shabbat, let your hands be enabled and strong, like those who are listening during these days to the words communicated by the prophets. God is not fond of the meek. The Beatitudes is BS. God constantly, throughout the Torah, tells his children, and particularly the shepherds who are leading them, Moshe and Yosha in particular, be strong. Be reliable. Be dependable. Be forceful. Yeah. Show some backbone. Be determined. Shazak. It is an exceedingly strong, tough, dependable, steadfast, empowered word that is the antithesis of meek. So let your actions be enabled and strong, those who are listening during these days to the words communicated by the prophets. You'll note that it's not the words by the rabbis. There's a couple of things that the rabbis got wrong. One is the word of God is filled with prophecy. They don't have any. Second, the word of God is filled with Yahweh's name. He is not mentioned. And third, the word of God is consistent with the word of God, and the Talmud is not. Moreover, the word of God comes to us from Yaruwshalaim, Yahudah, Yisrael, and the Talmud was written in Babylon. Those who have walked along the correct path to get the most out of life and enjoy the benefits of the relationship, Asher, can establish and lay the foundation during that time for the house of Yahowah, for the house of the family of Yahowah, of the spiritual messengers, so that the royal residence and temple will be built. I think you were asking this question a week ago, Kirk. Is it before the show began, actually? So here I'm talking out of school. But before the show began, that is it true that we're actually going to be working with Dode to build the house of Yah? And the answer appears to be yes.
That's what I picked up.
Yeah, I mean, he might even want a painting on a wall, for all I know.
Never know.
You never know. Might want a painting on the wall. Yeah, I am a frustrated architect, man. I can look at anything and figure out 100 ways to improve it. Now, God may not go along with my improvements. I'm really into capitalizing on the view. So I like lots of windows and big windows. And, you know, he may want to keep it a little more intimate. I don't know. He, for all I know, is an introvert versus those of us who are extroverts. He might like some peace and quiet. And, man, I want it happening, man. I want the light show and the visuals, and I want the lines to be elegant, and there's so many architectural elements. But nonetheless, we get to work. You'll probably have me with all of my ideas down there mixing mortar for chiseling stone. Hey, idiot, what are you doing? You're giving me advice on how to build my house. I already laid out the plans. I thought it was pretty cool. Actually, I don't think the house of Yah is going to model the one that is outlined in the Torah.
No,
I don't.
I don't know.
I actually think that this house, to a large degree, is going to be transparent. The source of light, I think, that's in it is going to radiate out. I think that that Dode's house, which will be placed below it on the same ridgeline of Zion on Mount Moriah, will be stately and beautiful. But Yahweh's house, I expect to be this beacon of light. I almost think of it as a diamond with multiple facets and the light being broken into its very prismatic colors.
A
bridge of light spanning between the two homes over the flow of living waters that are going to come out of olives and through the center of Jerusalem, running all the way to the sea, both to the what was the Dead Sea that will become the Living Sea, and the Mediterranean. I just think it's going to be a marvelous and beautiful sight. But now maybe I'm projecting my own thoughts on it. But, you know, one of the things that that becomes clear, as I told you, Kirk, that that today I finished chapter 9 of Introduction to God, volume 2. And the entirety of it is a translation and commentary on Mashal, Proverbs 3. And it is a note from a father to his son. And so it's from Yahowah to Dode, but it's an open letter because it applies to every child of the covenant family. And one of the concluding comments that is made in it is God says that I'm a proud father. This is my son, and I chose him. I'm proud of him. I'm delighted. In fact, I would even goes as far as to say, I think he's right. And of course, one of the reasons that Dode was right is that Yahweh inspired him to be right with what he wrote. And the reason we are right is that we have studied and accepted Yahweh's perspective. And if you accept Yahweh's perspective and you accept his testimony, then God's going to think you're right because you're correctly conveying what he said. It's pretty hard to be wrong under those circumstances.
Yeah.
So God does think that we're pretty cool. You know, I wrote at the end of this to say that when I read presentations like Mashal 3, that mm-hmm. I'm moved because that's how I see God. I know a lot of people put God, you know, up there on the pedestal. God's really big. He's powerful. He's, you know, he's worth praising and all this. That's not my relationship with him. I'm not telling you need to change yours. It's yours. It's different. But my relationship with Yahweh is Dad. We have a very comfortable, mm-hmm. casual, friendly, familiar relationship. He's Dad. I'm the kid. He's my guide, my protector, my teacher, the one responsible for raising me, chastising me when necessary, chiding me on occasion, correcting me quite often. That's our relationship, and I'm comfortable that I like it. And you don't very often see Yahweh's response to that. And Yahweh's response is, I love him. I love him. I cherish him. I value him. I care deeply about him. He means a lot to me. And I think that's true with every member of the covenant. You know, there are some that are exceptional. We were talking about in this program, Saint Jackie, you know, for example. But tongue in cheek, but you know, she is an extraordinary individual. And I can't tell you how happy I am with the wonderful job David's done in creating the website.
Cool.
and how beautiful it looks, and it works on every platform, and how it's getting better and better. You know, and
I use it every day.
Yeah, we have some wonderful family members, and Yahweh is proud. And so this house that we're building for Yahweh, it's our house too.
Hmm.
It's our family. Our house, our family. You know, we're going to Brother Dode, Uncle Moshe, mm-hmm. you know, they're all going to be there. And we're family. So I do think that we get to do more here. And this is really a joyous moment. So I think we get to do more here than just lay bricks. Chisel stone and lay bricks. And I just don't think that this house is going to be like the others. I think God's going to say, all right, let's have some fun with this. We're all here. Let's do it right. That's where we're headed. So Yaruwshalaim is going to become the most glorious place on earth. Its heart will be Yahweh, while the souls are the people of the covenant. The day that God can once again say, these are my people, and I am their God. It was predicted, of course, by Hosea, having forgotten the Torah and breached the terms of the covenant. Yahweh divorced Yisrael, but now the family is back together again. Yeah, you know, and Hosea says, they are not my children. And then he says, but a time will come where they will be my children and I will be their God.
Yes.
This is that time. This is the most important day in all of history from Yahweh's point of view. I think it's the second most important day for humanity. I think the most important day on humanity was the fulfillment of matzah.
Yes.
But second to that is the fulfillment of Kipurym. But that's our perspective. I think from Yahweh's perspective, matzah wasn't so much fun. But Kipurym will be a grand celebration. So for a very long time, Yehudim have been dishonest. But Yahweh has remained trustworthy. The people have been unreliable, while God has been dependable. So with these words, Yahweh is affirming that he did not change. So for this to occur, Yisrael has to start listening to the voice of the prophets. And that's such a remarkable thing, because right now, Yisrael, Israelites, Israelis, and Jews listen to the rabbis if they're among the 20% who are religious.
Yeah, they do it all. Yeah.
They listen to their politicians if they're Israelis who are more secular. And boy, are they political. I mean, wow. I mean, there are that is a political community, I'll tell you. Or they are atheists and they listen to libertards. There are, boy, are there a lot of progressive Jews. And
I know what.
They're as lost as the religious are. So the last place that Jews are listening is to the prophets. So to catch their attention and cause them to listen to the voice of the prophets, really two things has to change. One is the text of the prophecies has to be conveyed in the language that most Jews speak.
Correct. Agreed, yes.
Yeah. And second, it has to be made relevant to them. It's got to be presented to them in such a way that it says, let me explain to you why God is so different than the Hashem presented by the rabbis. Let me explain to you why the history of Yisrael has been so bleak. Let me tell you what God said, what he is like, what he is offering, and what he is expecting in return. And when all this is going to transpire. For them to listen to the prophets, they need an explanation. Now, there is a day when this explanation that we're providing and the translations we're providing will be absolutely, totally, and completely worthless. They will have done their job. Yahweh's going to scribe. He's going to actually, what he says, he's placing his Torah teaching inside of us and going to write it on our hearts, which is our seat of judgment, so that it influences our decisions. And at that point, we're not going to need any explanation. But right now, you've got a very small number of Israelites and Yehudim who know Yahweh and are listening to him, and that's the role that God has asked us to play. So I had thought, and there is a statement that seems to indicate that Yahweh would be building his home for his family upon his return. But that's not entirely the case. In this particular case, Yahweh may be providing all of the heavy equipment, and all of the hard work will do. But we're going to be participants in it because, well, Yahweh prefers working with people. So there's hope for us. You could draw a picture that you love that, you know, I think I'd rather have something else. I could put a window someplace that says, wow, look at that view. And he goes, I'm not so sure. But the thing that Yahweh loves is working with his creation, with people, which means he gets a sense of enjoyment when his thoughts and his plans are filtered through our eyes and our perspective. So my guess, he'd say, yeah, that's a nice window. Good picture. Where should we put the picture? Right? How about in front of the window?
Maybe I'll do a full finished window.
There we go. So we're going to get a chance to invest a little sweat equity into our eternal home. It is a new world. It's a different time, with the object of continuous scorn being seen as the ultimate blessing, the prophet says. And just as you have been accursed and vilified, ridiculed and demeaned among the Gentiles, I will deliver you, sparing you from this family of Yehudah and house of Yisrael, such that you will become a blessing and a source of peace. Fear not, you will prevail and have your influence restored.
Oh, what a promise.
Yeah, we have seen Jews accursed, vilified, ridiculed, and demeaned for a very long time. They were accursed, demeaned, vilified by the Mitzrayim, corrupted to Egyptians. It means crucibles of religious and political oppression. We saw them ridiculed and demeaned and accursed, implicated, found contemptible by the Assyrians. The same was true with the Babylonians. The same was true three times by the Romans. Same was true by the Muslims. Same is true by the Europeans, and particularly the Nazis. Same is true today, not only by Muslims, but also by the libertards, the progressives of this world. And so we have a long history of Jews being accursed and vilified, ridiculed, and demeaned, being the victims of contemptible conspiracies, of groundless theories. And so many of those are raising their ugly heads again. And it's Gentiles, non-Israelis, that that Jews will have to be delivered from. But he says, I'm going to do that. I'm going to deliver you. I'm going to spare you from all of this. Family of Yahudah, house of Yisrael, such that you become a blessing and a source of peace. You will prevail. Your influence will be restored. And what was the influence of Yisrael? It's only one. And what's amazing here is with all of the millions of Yisraelites who have come and gone, there's only 40 of them that made a difference. 40. They were the prophets. For thus says Yahowah of the spiritual messengers. Now, throughout this, it's Yahowah Shabbat. And, you know, sometimes you say, boy, how many times is he going to say Yahowah Shabbat?
Many as he wants.
And why, I guess many as he wants, Why in this context is he so Yahowah Shabbat, Yahowah the spiritual messenger? I think it's because the Malach play a very, very big role in the days prior to Yahweh's return. I think there's a lot of things going on. One is that the family, the covenant family, prior to the Teruah harvest, needs protection. Needs inspiration, needs support, and so the Malach are there as emissaries representing Yahowah. There are those of us who have stirred up a few hornets' nests by condemning Islam, exposing and condemning Pauline Christianity, exposing and condemning rabbinical Judaism, exposing and condemning liberalism, communism, Marxism, wokeism. And you just can't attack that many isms and survive it unless the Malach of Yahowah, who formed the Shabbat, are actively engaged. The whole impetus of the 91st Mizmor Psalm. So it is a time when we have to rely on them. That banner that Yahowah spoke about, which is the giant scroll that will be in the sky, that's being held up by Mizmor. Not by Mizmor. It's being held up by the Shabbat, the Malach. So that's, I think, why we're there's so much action, so much testimony, so much change transpiring in the next 12 years, that the Malach are going to be very active, and therefore it is Yahowah Shabbat. This will be the most active the Shabbat have ever been. So thus says Yahowah of the spiritual messengers, based upon the status of the relationship, I had considered breaking you out of it when your fathers provoked me. Yahowah, the spiritual implements, said, and I did not relent. However, now I am intending upon my return at that time to do what is right and good for Yerushalayim and for the house of Yahudah. Fear not. I am happy, pleased that we read what has to be true, that Yahweh is not hiding this from us. 3,400 years of bad behavior of the people that he had rescued and saved, and that he communicated his testimony in their language and their presence through their people, and made all of these promises to, for those people, for 3,400 plus years, to constantly spit in his face, to rebel yeah. against him, to create their own scriptures, to create their own gods, to ignore him. I mean, the one place you will never find Yahweh's name is among a religious Jew. In fact, his name is not even mentioned in Israel. And here Israel picks a symbol for the ethnicity of Jews, for the nation, the politics of Israel, and for the religion of Judaism. And it's a goddamn Star of David.
Mm-hmm.
The one thing he said is don't be worshiping the sun of the stars. There is no Star of David. If you're going to pick a symbol, Yahweh's symbol is the menorah, which is the symbol that stood between the two witnesses during the last days. So not only have they spit in God's face, but they've renounced his name. They've renounced his presence. They speak out against him. And so it's good to see Yahweh telling us the truth, that based upon the status of the relationship, he had considered ending it because he had been provoked to the point where he couldn't stand it anymore. Nonetheless, God made a promise to Abraham, and despite the nastiness of the people, he's going to honor it, which means he's going to return on a day of reconciliations, and every Israelite who is willing to listen, open their minds, open their eyes, open their ears, listen and observe what Yahweh has to say, embrace him, come to appreciate what he is offering and asking in return, that he is going to reconcile his relationship with them, doing what is good and right. Going to do so in Jerusalem for the house of Yahudah. That's his promise. Now, if you are a Jew, you are an Israeli, this is your opportunity. God is willing to greet you with open arms. All you have to do is acknowledge who he is, accept the five conditions of the covenant, attend his Moed Mikre. Just acknowledge him. Accept him. Approach him. Stop ignoring him. And, you know, it's not just that you're going to have a nice reunion and won't it be fun, but from that point, eternity begins. We become seven-dimensional. We get to explore the universe. We get to camp out with our Father and Creator. It's worth doing, and it's an open invitation. So he's intending on doing what's right and good for Jerusalem and the house of Yahudah. These are the words which, for the benefit of the relationship, you should act upon. Speak the truth, demonstrating some integrity to one another. From friends to neighbors, from associates to nations, being trustworthy and honest, exercising good judgment, while deciding in favor of restoration and reconciliation on behalf of those with whom you can reason. Zechariah 8:16. Boy, isn't that a mouthful. Yeah, what a wonderful statement.
I picked that one up right away. Yeah.
Yeah. These are the words for which, for the benefits of the relationship, you should act upon. You should consider doing. Speak the truth. Boy, there haven't been a lot of Jews that have done that. Well, that's a little unfair to Jews. There have been a lot of people that have done that.
Truly.
Demonstrating integrity. Dabar emeth. Do so to one another. From friends to neighbors, associates to nations. Being trustworthy and honest. Exercising good judgment while deciding in favor of restoration and reconciliation. Doing so on behalf of those with whom you can reason. To a significant degree, Yahowah is simply asking us to be like him. Speak the truth.
Yeah.
Communicate to one another. Talk to anyone who is willing to listen. Be trustworthy and honest. Exercise good judgment. And ultimately, just as he announced, decide in favor of restoration and reconciliation. God is asking us to follow his example. Now, Jews have been vilified and demeaned for, well, every bit of 2,500 plus years. It's gotten old. It was dumb then, and it's stupid now. Every time someone ridicules or implicates Jews, it reveals the ignorance of the accuser. It causes God to despise them. These are very poor life choices. I am ready to see Yisrael's influence restored. I'm sure you are as well.
Yeah, certainly.
They were called to be God's witnesses, his prophets,
mm-hmm.
a shining example of the best we can be. Now, clearly, Jews have brought a significant degree of their torment upon themselves. Judaism is obnoxious. The outfits worn by the Hasidic, oh, they're just ridiculous. But nonetheless, all of the conspiratorial, political, and religious claims against Jews are unjustified. Feel free to condemn Judaism. Feel free to criticize Israeli politics. But you are not free to speak out against the ethnicity. Jews have managed to provoke God. Of that we can be certain. But we can also expect Yahowah to restore his relationship with his people. God will do what's right for them. So as the sands of time descend and mankind's hourglass, it is long past time that we finally learn to tell the truth. Let's stop lying to one another about religion and politics, about socialism and communism, especially about conspiracy, Israel, Jews, and Yahowah. Let's exercise some good judgment. Let's be honest, encouraging all who will listen to decide in favor of reconciliation. Fortunately, Yahweh has only asked us to communicate with those with whom we can reason, eliminating the need to talk with anyone who is overtly religious, political, or conspiratorial. They're a waste of breath. There is a book that will be published in Yisrael, I think next week. It is about the what's called the Abraham Accords, which Trump, to his credit, was the sponsor. Kirchner, I think, had a great say in it as well. But it was under the Trump administration that more progress was made in a shorter period of time than maybe any time in modern history. And that so Trump was being interviewed for the role that he and his administration played on something that was really extraordinary. And Trump couldn't get out of his own way. I mean, here is Trump having done something that the entire world should applaud. You know, he recognized that the Golan belonged to Israel and said so. He recognized that the U.S. Embassy belonged in Jerusalem and did so. He recognized that a treaty with Iran that allows them to continue to refine uranium so that they can prepare for a bomb is wrong, and that sanctions should be imposed on them. He was right. He was right about so many things in this regard. But now he's being interviewed over the Abraham Accords. Almost everything that he's done, the Biden administration has managed to undo. And he is fixated on a single thing. Slandering, dishing Benjamin Netanyahu. Now, I'm no fan of Benjamin Netanyahu. I think he's an egotistical maniac. And I think that the government he formed with the religious parties was a disaster for Israel. But nonetheless, he and Trump were buddies. And so when Bibi congratulated Biden on his win, Trump went ballistic. You know, he said it was a sign of disloyalty to him that Bibi would recognize the president of the United States, that the president of Israel would call to congratulate the president of the United States. And he said, F, Bibi.
Mm-hmm.
And then throughout the interview, all he could say is this fixation on how he had done so much for Bibi and he didn't appreciate the lack of loyalty. You know, Trumpster, it's not Bibi's job to be your lapdog. You want loyalty? Buy a Labrador. Trump's policies and many things compared to Biden's are vastly superior. But what a nincompoop. Good grief. No wonder he lost. This is the prophetic pronouncement of Yahweh's word concerning Yisrael. Yahweh, who spread out the universe and established the earth and who shaped the impulse for inside Adam and humankind, predicts. So that's saying, okay, you may want to listen to what I have to say, because I just happen to be God. My word is trustworthy and true. I am the one that established Yisrael. I am the one that spread out the universe. I am the one who conceived the earth. I'm the one who shaped the impulse for the spirit inside of Adam, humankind. And this is what I am predicting. So, it's not very often that God talks to us from that perspective.
Mm-hmm.
But when he does, you ought to take notice. So, in this proclamation, Yahweh attests that the universe is expanding, and that the fabric of space bends. And while we know these things now, circa 500 BCE, we did not. With this statement, another piece of the puzzle also falls into place. The Bereshit Genesis account tells us that Yahweh gave man, like all other animals, a nephesh soul, or consciousness, to make him a living creature. Then Yahweh revealed that he equipped Adam with a neshama, conscience, to elevate him unto the likeness of God himself. Our conscience is our nesama. It's our seat of judgment. It's what enabled Adam and us to differentiate between right and wrong, to discriminate between good and bad, to judge between the ways of Yahweh and those of man. Therefore, our conscience is what God conceived within humankind to make us receptive to the Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
With it, in addition to our nephesh, humankind is equipped to live in Yahweh's presence. Now, with this realization, one of Christendom's biggest myths is busted. There's obviously no such thing as original sin. The Catholic Church's position that a child must be baptized in pagan fashion to be purged of Adam's stain is erroneous. From Yahweh's perspective, and his is the only one that matters, Adam was conceived with the means to restore the relationship. His Nesama conscience was passed on from father to son, but not his sin.
That was a great connection, by the way.
Yeah, it is.
Some great dives.
Yeah, we gain the conscience, the ability to discern good from bad, right from wrong. But we are not stained with his mistake.
By the fall of the sins. Yeah.
Correct.
Great.
This note, while most people are likely imbued with a conscience today, most have a inoperable nesama. It runs on logic when fed accurate information. Religion and politics are its nemesis. The former gums up the works with faulty programming and errant data, while the latter renders judgment offensive. Now, that's a fairly profound thought.
Mm-hmm.
So most people, while they have a nesama today, it has been rendered inoperable. That's why they can't exercise good judgment. I was talking with a friend of mine at lunch, and he dearly loves his wife. He's loyal to his wife, but his wife is a libertard. And he cannot have a conversation with her about politics because as a progressive, evidence and reason does not matter. She can't process facts. She can't appreciate the importance of logic and of forming conclusions based upon making the right connections. Completely lost on her. This is an example of what religion and politics do to people. The same thing would be true with a religious person. Religion gums up the works, literally with faulty programming and errant data, while politics now renders judgments offensive. That's the whole nature of political correctness, of wokeism.
And that's
now, with this
why
in mind,
said earlier. No, I'm just going to say, you said it earlier. You don't have to argue with these people if they have no logic. If they can't talk to them in a logical approach, don't waste your time.
That's a waste of time.
Excuse me.
Even God can't convince a religious person to embrace him.
Yes.
With this in mind, let's examine what God predicted would occur in our not too distant future. He says, "Behold, I am preserving Jerusalem as the threshold and doorway of reeling and staggering intoxication for all of the surrounding people and for those against Yehudah. This will exist during the siege against Jerusalem." So, God is not only returning to Jerusalem on behalf of his people, and then when he does, those that remnant who has survived will be recognized by God as family. They will recognize Yahweh as their God. But there are those who are still looking, coveting this place, searching for Al-Barak, the winged ass. And for those people in search of the Hopi print, God says, you are so stupid that I'm just going to make all of this a source of reeling and staggering intoxication for you. Everyone who is against Yehudah, against Jews, this will be your stumbling block. As you try to besiege my city, you will be besieged yourself. Well, so much for the just the future, I guess. This is really happening today, isn't it?
Conquest, yes, the Caesar already doing it, yeah.
Yeah, of Jerusalem is the insane rant of Muslims and progressives around the world. And is the catalyst for Islamic terrorism for the Muslims surrounding the city. We have a huge uptick in violence right now in Israel. The fake Assyrians are going berserk.
Oh,
you know, pay for slay is so much a part of their mindset. You can see films of young Palestinian, fake Palestinian boys stabbing defenseless, unarmed young men walking on the sidewalk. One happened right after that, where they stabbed a pregnant woman who had already had five children, and they're stabbing her with a knife. They're throwing bricks into cars and ripping the people out. It is a horrible time, and they're being inspired to believe that they're the real
and justified,
observing
and
peoples, of Israel and Jerusalem. And it's utter and complete nonsense. It's amazing what people will be led to believe and how badly they will act out upon a lie. But Yisrael was given to Jews by Yahweh. And their most formidable foe for years was the Philistines, which were wiped out by the Assyrians. There's no such thing as a Philistine. They're all gone. And they were not the inhabitants of the land anyway. They came from Crete, from Cyprus, from the Mediterranean islands. They were the remnants of probably the bad boys
had to get out of there.
The Miocene civilization. And to a large degree are very similar to the Phoenicians and the Punic peoples of Carthage, but they were sort of the renegades. They didn't have a language even of their own, so they spoke and wrote in Hebrew. And they were vicious. As Dode said, you know, you're a loudmouthed, disgusting, uncircumcised Philistine. And so to call oneself a Philistine and to claim a place called Palestine is to be completely ignorant of its history. There is no basis for it outside of the Torah and prophets, and in the Torah and prophets, there is no basis for it. What I mean by that is that without the Torah and prophets, no one's ever heard of a Philistine. No one's ever heard of Palestine. No one's ever heard of it. And with the Torah and prophets, those people aren't deserving. They're enemies of God. They were not given the land, and they were hauled off into to slavery and ultimately annihilated by the Assyrians. So they don't exist. So the whole thing is just a pointless lie, and yet they're killing for that lie. Having interviewed Islamic terrorists in proximity to Jerusalem after 9/11 in late 2001, and then having compiled Prophet of Doom, I understand the stupefying effects of religion in general and Islam in particular. Now, this conclusion becomes readily apparent when we witness enraged Muslim youth lashing out with rocks, crude incendiary devices, bottle rockets, and firecrackers while building barricades comprised of burning tires and trash. They are mentally disabled, emotionally dysregulated, morally compromised. It's as if they were operating under the influence of the world's most debilitating drug. Muslims and the liberals who support them are unable to comprehend that there is no basis to the Palestinian claim to Jerusalem. There are no Palestinians. There is no Palestine. The Philistines, whose name they are commandeering, they are not native to the land, but instead to the island of Crete. Their borders never existed outside of the Gaza Strip. Ever. They were wiped out by the Assyrians 2,600 years ago. As for the claim that Jerusalem is the third holiest site in Islam, we've talked about it, that's equally ignorant.
Yeah.
No, it's based on Quran and Hadith stories that are enormously embarrassing to the religion. God is telling us that the Islamic rage behind the seas of Jerusalem and Judea is intoxicating, such that there is no merit in trying to negotiate with them. One cannot reason with a Muslim. Those who try to engage or coddle them display their ignorance, the ignorance of the Quran and the Hadith and Muhammad's alter ego, Allah. Now, that does not mean that we ought to be tormenting them. You know, I had a discussion with my wife this afternoon. She had posted something on social media, speaking out against the fakestinians and saying, you know, we have a right to defend ourselves and that we're not going anywhere. And I said, you know, it's fine for you to write that. It's all true and everything. But there is this upsurgence of settler violence right now against Muslims, where they're chanting, you know, death to Arabs. They're when a Muslim throws bricks into Jewish car windows with their family riding inside, they will reciprocate and throw bricks into a Muslim civilian car. And what I said is,
we don't turn into them.
That's stupid. You do not prevail and take the high ground over Islamic terrorism by acting like an Islamic terrorist.
Mm-hmm.
That's not the right thing to do. Is to use your words for Israel as a whole to stop referring to a place called Palestine, stop referring to Palestinians, call them what they are. They're Muslims. Deal with the religion as it is, which is a terrorist dogma. And explain that they have no claims, that their very existence is a lie. Use your words. Don't resort to throwing stones. Now, returning to that which is credible, Yahowah revealed that the Islamic misconceptions regarding Jerusalem and misappropriation of the city is going to be their undoing. This is Zechariah, remember Yahowah, Zechariah 12:3. It shall be during this time that I will cause Yaruwshalaim to be an immovable stone for all these people. Everyone who attempts to move it will lacerate and impale themselves. And yet Gentiles from every ethnicity, nation, religion, and place on earth will gather against it. So God said, you know, have at it,
didn't
man.
Leave anybody out, did it?
You want to come? You want a piece of me?
Come on.
Go ahead and try. Let's see. For those that have come to attack Israel, who want a piece of Jerusalem, claiming it, who want to kill Jews, you just go right ahead and try. Do you see how that works out for you? They're going to fall on their own swords. They're going to cut off their own feet. They're going to die by their own words. So it shall be during that time that I will cause Yaruwshalaim to be an immovable stone for all of these people. Everyone who attempts to move it will lacerate and impale themselves. And yet the Gentiles from every ethnicity, nation, religion, and place on earth. Kol Goyim Ha Eretz will gather against it. I mean, at some point you got to say, yeah. Why are you fighting against God?
You know, too
why,
short.
Why would you want to fight against God? It's not going to work out for you. This story has a happy ending. And if you are a Muslim, it isn't going to work out well for you. Man is a slow learner. Some will never understand. Among our worst choices is to oppose Yahowah, his people, and his place. The earth is littered with the ruins of nations and institutions that have tried. To this day, Jerusalem is the most contested place on the planet. It is the capital of the Jewish homeland, a gift from God to everyone the world over seems set on taking it away and giving it to religious terrorists. In keeping with cancel culture and political correctness, the truth is disparaged to establish a myth. You know, Israel's a tiny place. I think it represents 0.2% of the land in the Islamic Middle East. 0.2%. There is no shortage of land in the Islamic countries. They are, for the most part, very sparsely populated. I mean, the Sinai is still an open wilderness, as is most of Egypt. Jordan is mostly huge tracts are uninhabited. The majority of Saudi Arabia is lightly or uninhabited. If the Crown Prince Mohammed continues to have his way with Yemen, it will be mostly uninhabited. There just isn't a shortage of land in the Islamic world. They don't covet Israel because, they need a homeland. They need a place.
Mm-hmm.
No, they covet it because they hate Jews. Jerusalem and Judea will continue to be under siege between now and Yahweh's return on Yom Kippurim. The only thing which is going to change is the source of belligerence, the size of the assault, and the caliber of weapons being brought to bear against God's people. In this case, Yahweh is speaking of the Magog War. It's an assault triggered by Muslims after the fall of Syria, which will ultimately engulf the world in conflict as nations take sides. Boy, I tell you what, the world's in an exceedingly dangerous place. I think there's now only around 15 countries in the world that support Taiwan. And systematically now, China is going to each of the 15 countries or so that still support Taiwan's independence and bribing the leaders and bribing those countries, saying, you know, if you turn on Taiwan and say Taiwan has no right to exist, that it's part of China, then we will give this money to you as a leader and we'll give this kind of investment into your country. They're literally bribing people so that there is no country left that will support Taiwan, and they're going to invade. It's certain. And Russia right now is viewing the Ukraine like we view like the U.S. viewed the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Although the Ukraine is probably worse, because in the Ukraine the revolution that overthrew the pro-Russian government was staged by the United States.
Mm-hmm.
Equipped and staged by the United States and financed by the United States. And so we overthrew the government of the Ukraine because, well, we wanted a place for NATO to go and play and have fun. And then we supplied, which are probably the most unethical people on the planet. The Ukrainians are exceedingly unethical. With many, many billions of dollars of U.S. military hardware. Now, this is a country, a region that had been part of Russia for many hundreds of years. It has Russia's most important pipeline running right through it, that Russia had supported financially, and we took it over in the West, the United States leading the charge, because, well, we wanted a playground for NATO troops and for American weapons, and we wanted to do what Khrushchev attempted to do with Cuba, which was arm a place on the Russian border near the Russian heartland, and we've done so. So Russia's saying, you know, why should we put up with you continuing to put weapons and armaments in Ukraine? And why should we allow the Ukraine, this illegitimate government, to harass the ethnic Russians that are in the eastern part of the country? And so Russia has put, 100,000 troops on the border. And Putin is doing everything he can say you have given me no alternative but to go in and protect the ethnic Russians. And I would not be surprised if he says, you know, I don't have anything to lose anymore. This is the Cuban Missile Crisis played in reverse. And so the world's in a very dangerous place. And then you've got Turkey, which has imploded. Erdogan has done everything wrong, and their economy is in free fall, and there are riots throughout the country. And you've got them treating the Kurds, which are the largest ethnic minority in the world without a homeland, as terrorists, and attacking them where the United States is equipping them to fight a proxy war against the Iranian-backed Hezbollah troops. And you've got China and Russia siding with Iran and Hezbollah and Shia Islam because of the oil and the pipelines around the Caspian Sea. And then you have Europe and the United States siding with Saudi Arabia and the Sunni Muslims against the Shia. The world's an exceedingly dangerous place.
Mm-hmm.
And then you add to that the disruption of world economies, which typically leads to war. And America is very close to entering a period of economic collapse, of a Great Depression, and of runaway inflation. Mm-hmm. That's how much damage we have done to our economy. Supply lines have been horribly destroyed because liberal leaders tried to control the economy to say who could work and who was essential, not having any clue how complex they are. And then their answer to everything is let's throw pretend money at it. Let's create the illusion of money and trillion here, a trillion there, several trillion more here, a few more trillion there. And all you do is destroy incentive. You destroy the value of your currency, you destroy your economy, you create a ticking time bomb with debt. And that's where we are. It's a very, very dangerous world. And at the same time, we have the liberals in charge of education where everything is cancel culture and wokeism and truth no longer matters. You're rendering the generations of people completely incapable of thinking. A very dangerous time we live in.
Can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
Well, I was reading today where they were about the economy, and they were talking about companies. Large companies are looking at 30% input cost. You know, they just cannot. They have to pass that on. So there's no way they're gonna eat it. So that's, every price on just about everything in America is going to go up substantially.
They can't
they can't
hire people because they don't want to work. Mm-hmm. And they the whole you can work out of home and give it as much time as you want or as little time as you want created an entirely different culture in terms of value that people are providing. They the supply chains are so screwed up that the cost of materials are sky high. The ability to deliver anything is so screwed up that goods are sitting in harbors so people can't get supplies. We have taken China to the point where they supply almost everything that we buy in this country, and yet we're going into a rhetorical war with them. It's just hopelessly screwed up and way beyond fixing.
Yeah.
And who knows how long we're going to deal with all of the constraints of Corona.
Yes.
So anyway, God says during that time, Yahowah, that declares prophetically, I will strike and destroy every fast-moving and flying weapon of war by confusing the drivers, causing them to be irrational and erratic. It wouldn't take much to confuse the pilots and drivers of military equipment. Not much at all, because they're all now functioning on the GPS system. And you knock out the GPS system, an electromagnetic blast would do it. You knock that out, and they're blind as bats. Our precision-guided weapons aren't precision anymore. Our drones. I mean, the reason that you can control a drone from far away is because of the GPS systems. You know, they have a moving map. They know exactly where they are because of GPS. You put that pilot who is sitting there in a trailer someplace in the desert 10, 15,000 miles away, and all they've got is steam gauges and visual clues. Ain't no way he could find the target, much less get that drone back. It'd be falling out of the sky like birds full of buckshot. And so it wouldn't take much for Yahowah to fulfill this part of this prophecy. I will strike and destroy every fast-moving flying weapon of war by confusing the drivers, causing them to be irrational and erratic. Now, this would have required considerable intervention some years ago, but now it can be achieved with, as I mentioned, an EMP blast or corrupted programming. Almost all weapons of war are GPS guided, such that a crippling of the system would render the driver and rider alike panicking them in enemy airspace. And make no mistake, the Chinese and the Americans and the Russians all have anti-satellite weapons. The Russians recently tested one of theirs and almost took out the space station that had Russian cosmonauts in it.
I know that.
And the big war impetus now is on these hypersonic weapons, so that we can nuke one another at blazing speed. They're much, much faster than the old intercontinental ballistic missiles. What they do is they shorten the time that it takes to go up. The time that it comes to go down is already more than ballistic.
Very fast. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Now, as a pilot, I can tell you that I became dependent upon GPS and moving map displays within my aircraft. I stopped carrying paper charts and relied upon redundant electronic systems, all powered by the means of global positioning satellites. If that system failed, I would have been poorly equipped to navigate around complex airways. Now, I was trained. Steam gauges, man. I could triangulate between the VORs, and I learned how to do it, and I did enough of it to know that I would never do it again, and that that now no one is trained such they could even do it. And so without GPS, we'd be lost. Like, I wouldn't be surprised without GPS, most people couldn't figure out how to drive their car. Most people, they say, you know, where you want to go, they put it in their and the GPS in their car or on their phone, and it'll say, turn right, turn left. Zeus, which is that fast-flying weapons of war, is most often used in connection and correlation with swiftly moving military machines, especially mounted cavalry and chariots. It depicts something which is ridden in flight. All of this ties nicely into Rakab, which speaks of drivers and thus provides us with a glimpse of the weaponry which will be brought to bear against Israel, Yerushalayim, and Yahudim. So, for the sake of the house of Yahudah, Yahweh says, I'm going to keep my eyes open. And therefore, every one of these peoples, fast-moving and flying weapons of war, I will afflict with the inability to see.
Yay.
It's just not going to work out well. God has never missed on a prophecy. He is not missing now. It's just a really bad idea. I mean, I'm sorry, Biden administration, but this is a bad plan that you're on. You ought not be trying to negotiate with the Iranians on a new deal. You know, you ought to destroy their nuclear capability, and we can do it with our bunker-busting bombs. But if you wait too late, destroying it is going to be catastrophic. It needs to be done. It is one of a million lacerations upon the heart of Christianity. Right up to the end, Yahweh's attention is focused on the house of Yahudah. He is coming to support his people against the likes of the Goyim, Christians, and Muslims who are in opposition to them. There is no room in these words for replacement theology. And without it, there is no basis for Christianity. Now, as man's weapons have become more technologically sophisticated, they have become more vulnerable. There is not much that can go wrong with an unguided bomb. Although, boy, if you look at the newsreels of us bombing in the Second World War or in Vietnam, you'd realize, well, there's not
everybody.
Much that can go wrong. There's not much that can go right either. But a variety of errors can send a smart bomb astray. Similarly, a pilot flying a magnetic compass heading is not blinded and disoriented by the failure of modern avionics linked to the global positioning satellites, because those skills are no longer taught. It's like the inability to do multiplication in one's head after the development of calculators. No one does it. And yet, if you can't do multiplication and division in your head, it's very difficult to really think logically. As mentioned previously, a significant electromagnetic energy pulse, the right time and place, would render the world's positioning and communication systems inoperable. And because the United States is so dependent upon them, China, with superior numbers of manpower and old-fashioned bludgery capability, would do well to take them out. And, you know, what really is the United States going to do when China decides that they want to invade and occupy Taiwan? What are we going to do? We're going to stamp our feet and say, no, no, no. We're going to send an aircraft carrier over there that says, no, no, no. What are we going to do? Realistic. What are we going to do? Are we going to boycott China and preclude about, 90% of the raw earth elements that the technological world runs on? Are we going to preclude the things that the people buy in the store because they're not made in America anymore. What are we going to do? Now, truthfully, what were we going to do when Russia says, I've had enough of NATO's and America's arming and equipping what was our country in the Ukraine? What are we going to do? More sanctions? We've already put sanctions on them to the point that it's ridiculous. What are we going to do? Everything we've touched militarily has turned to mush. What have we done since World War II that's had a desirable effect? Certainly not the Korean War. Look at what the mess we made and we left. Certainly not Vietnam.
Vietnam, Laos.
Certainly not the invasion of Iraq and Afghanistan. I mean, are we going to claim Grenada? And,
sorry.
You know, if you look at World War II, we really made a mess of things. We left Europe worse than we found
it
because we kicked out Hitler and we allowed the Soviet Union to control even a greater swath of territory. And they were even more oppressive. And in the Pacific, what do we do there? I mean, we lost 3,000 men to our own stupidity in Pearl Harbor, and we avenged their death by sacrificing 300,000? And there's nothing here that says that America's military has been of any value. So while God's going to strike down those who openly demonstrate that they have no regard for his people or the promises he's made to them, Yahweh's going to continue to support those who love him and who rely upon him. Zechariah 12:5. Then the close friends and lovers of Yahudah will use their best judgment to say, for me, those who live and remain in Yerushalayim are supported and empowered, strengthened, equipped, and enabled by Yahweh, their God, and his conscripts who assist. It is a good thing to be in favor of Yahudah, means the beloved of Yah.
Mm-hmm.
There is today a major emphasis by the rabbis of claiming that someone is not Jewish if they're not into Judaism, and only their strain of Judaism counts. They would demean the Orthodox. They would demean the Reform. And so they have created this myth that Judaism and being Jewish are ubiquitous. So when God condemns Judaism and says that he wants to reconcile his relationship with those who are Jewish, God is not being anti-Semitic, nor are we when we take that approach. The rabbis are wrong. So we are pro-Yisrael because Yahweh is. We are pro-Yahudah because Yahweh is. Our mission is to awaken Yisrael and Yahudah so that they come home to Yah. This is our job. This is what Yahweh wants. And so we are leading the chorus of those who say that Yerushalayim is supported, empowered, equipped, and enabled by Yahweh. We are the friends and lovers of what it really means to be Yahud, beloved of Yah. The champions and confidants of Yahudah, and those who are engaged in a familial relationship with Yahweh's beloved, we are few and far between. We are resolutely committed to the well-being of God's people and to the sanctity of his place. We celebrate the benefits associated with trusting Yahweh to empower and equip his family to accomplish whatever he needs done. Now, should you be confused by the fact that we, like Yahweh, are resolutely opposed to Judaism and to rabbis, it is because they are Yehuda's most debilitating foes. That's tough to hear if you're a Jew. But the truth is, according to God, the most debilitating adversary to Yisrael and to Yahudim are rabbis in Judaism. Those who are attacking Israel are using weapons which are readily disabled, as God has told us, while the festering disease of religion strikes at the heart of its prey, and it metastasizes to the point that there is no longer any distinction between the individual and the institution. So yes, Yisrael, Yahudah, and Yerushalayim will be relentlessly and ruthlessly attacked by moronic and barbaric Muslims, by idiotic Christians, by thoughtless multiculturalists, progressives, and communists. But with Yahweh's protection, it will remain the safest place on earth for the chosen people. As God says, be not afraid. Come home. Usually translated of hosts, we discussed this a moment ago. Yahweh's Shabbat are comprised of Malach. They are spiritual messengers and heavenly envoys, and they are a regiment of living implements, energy-based beings akin to light, who are perfectly arranged to serve, always doing as God requests. The Saba are marshaled to perform and assign roles and to engage in all manner of spiritual battles. While Yahweh's Malach messengers and envoys, whom we errantly call angels, have no free will. They have access to and work on behalf of the just sovereign of the universe. It is really a marvelous job. There are no complaints. Returning to Zechariah, we find that sides have been chosen, and all that remains is watching this contest unfold. Now, all of this is all of the hoopla that leads to Yahweh's return on the day of reconciliations, October 2nd, 6:22 p.m. in Yerushalayim in 2033. On that day, I will cause the close friends, related family, and lovers of Yahudah to be like a flaming pulpit in the timbers and like a blazing torch among the stalks of fallen grain. And they will devour them to the right and to the left, enveloping all of the surrounding armies and peoples, while Yerushalayim shall continue to be inhabited, succeeding with one thing logically following another through time in Yerushalayim. We're going to be transformed into light.
That's what I'm reading.
Yep. Close friends, related family, and lovers of Yahudah will be like a kayor, esh, a fiery platform upon a stage, a blazing cauldron, a hearth, a forge, and a smelting furnace in the timbers and amongst the combustible materials. And that's such an interesting thing. So here we are, this flaming, fiery pulpit, and we're blazing amongst the combustible material, which is the mortals that have come against Israel. We're like a torch showing the way, a firebrand and shining flame among the stalks of the fallen grain, which represent the religious, the political, those who have come to attack God's people. They're worthless, and they're being devoured by this flame. You know, there's this reference a number of places. Here is one of them, where at this time, those who speak out on behalf of Yahweh, who defend Yerushalayim, who defend Israelites, they will consume those opposing them as a flame would consume the rubble. And that's what's happening here. This is not a time to argue with God. It's not a time to argue with his people. So it's not just the Malak that will be engaged. So will Yahweh's family. We're going to get to not only build Yahweh's house, but defend his people. And our weapon is going to be light, fire. And you know how we're going to spread that fire, how that torch is going to work? It's going to be through our words. And it will consume. It will absolutely incinerate everything that is opposed to Yahweh, his people, and his place. Devouring, enveloping all the surrounding armies and people, while Yaruwshalaim will remain inhabited. All of this is going to happen, including Yahweh's return, with one event following another. So what word was it you looked up, Kirk?
No, it wasn't that so much as I looked up all of them just to make sure. Yeah, that's exactly what he's saying. So it wasn't one epiphany or something. It was just, I had to do that a couple of times. And, wow, that's really what he says.
Yeah, and Yahweh, presents himself during the Yatsa, the Exodus, as being a brilliant fiery light. That he was represented by fire on the top of the mountain, and then he was a pillar of fire during the night. So Yahweh is presenting himself as radiant energy, as light. And what is he saying of his covenant children? We're going to be radiant energy and light. We're going to be flaming, just as Yahweh presented himself in this world. So our presence in this world will be identical to our God's, which means that our God is making us ever more like him. And fire has so many wonderful qualities that I think one of the reasons that Yahweh likes fire so much as a metaphor, and he uses the fire, coming to the presence of the maternal spirit, the fiery light of your spiritual mother during the Moed Mikra, is that what fire does is it transforms physical, organic material, our decaying bodies, into light. It's that it is literally consumes one to turn it into the other. So it's such a perfect metaphor. It enlightens, it warms, it draws attention, perfects both water and food so that the toxins are removed and it's more nourishing. It's very inviting when we're camping out. And it's stunningly empowering. It's what drove the Industrial Revolution, is fire. It's still what we use to generate electricity. We heat water. A fire of one sort or another, boiling water to turn a steam turbine, is how we make electricity. It is the source of our power, has been and continues to be. It brought light to a dark world so we could read the Torah and be with our families and enjoy one another's company even after the sun goes down. It's the thing that we all try to build if we're camping out and want to keep the beasties at bay.
That too, yes.
We use it to cook our food, to boil our water, to warm ourselves at night, to keep the beasts at bay, to create a atmosphere around which we can enjoy one another and family. And it is this transformative effect, taking the decaying nature of matter and transforming it into the power of energy. perhaps that's a good place for us to stop, Kirk. We've
okay.
We covered a lot of territory here, but it's hard not to like what the Yahweh was offering.
Well,
and this is going to be an amazing time.
Yeah. You know,
we're talking about the return of our God to earth.
You're talking about some horrible things that the world will encounter, but it's very comforting to me that we're doing what Yah wants, and secondly, it's very comforting to me that he's providing protection for Yehudim to come back to Israel.
Yeah, what's comforting to me is that he's told the whole story to us.
Oh, yeah.
He's told us exactly what's going to happen and when it's going to happen and how it's going to happen and how you can avoid being on the wrong side of this and how you can enjoy being on the right side.
Yeah.
He's eliminated all the guesswork. It's all right here for you. It's all going to transpire over the next 12 years. You have no excuse. Now, capitalize on it. God is offering you the opportunity to be transformed into light energy, to be his sons and daughters in a very real way, to protect us, to empower us, to enlighten us, to liberate us, to enjoy our company, to eliminate our enemies, to live with us, to build a home together, to protect the family together, to transform the earth back into conditions of Eden where there are no predators, no foes, no religious, no political, no adversaries, no conspiratorialists. It's a marvelous thing that he's offering. It's so easy to be on the right side, and there's so many benefits on the right side, and there is nothing to be gained to be on the wrong side of this.
No. I'm just amazed. What a chapter. Wow.
Yeah, and it's we've got more about Yom Kippurim. God has a lot to say about it. We'll even go through the end of Zechariah, and then into Malachi, who has a lot to say about it as well. And really, I can't wait to get into ITG, the Introduction to God. That boy, it has grown from what I originally thought was fairly pedantic and dry into an exceedingly revealing story. It's such a perfect place now for particularly Israelites and Yehudim, Jews and Israelis, to start in their quest to come to know God. I don't know what I like more now, the three volumes on the Moed Mikre, which are invitations, harvests, and appointments, or if it's an Introduction to God, Volume 1 and Volume 2. I will tell you, though, one thing that I'm grateful for is that my wife told me, you know, that I would not give your books to a fellow Jew. You know, based upon what you and we have learned, your books are outdated. You've got too much in them that we've learned is different than what we had thought. And you really need to rewrite them, and then we need to come up with a way of presenting them as a family. And we need to change the look so it reflects better upon Yahowah. And I said, you know, that's what you say is probably true, but you realize that what you've just done, if I accept this, is 3 years of my life. I mean, it's not just 3 years of my life. It's 10 hours a day, 6 and 7 days a week.
It's consuming.
For the next 3 years. And there was a period of time when I said, oh my God, there's no way I'm ever going to get through this. And then something happened where just the process of retranslating these passages and thinking about them and sharing the insights became more revealing, more meaningful, more effective, more beneficial than translating something new and writing about it. It was like all day today, and going back over the third Mashal, proverb, something I haven't considered, read, translated in more than 10 years. And to see that jewel and to be able to share it, oh, it's the best thing that ever could have happened. And, you know, now as I turn around and look behind me, and I've got both in the hardback and the paperbacks, I guess 20 volumes that we currently have done. I'm 4 chapters and 100 pages to having the second volume of ITG done. And my goodness, it is such an enormous wealth of information. And it's sort of an out-of-body experience to read these. I can't help it, but almost every day I take one of the books and just open it and start reading it. It's profound. It's no matter where you engage this, the material that God's words, His prophetic revelations, His teachings, are so profound. They're riveting. They're uplifting. They're nurturing to our minds, to our souls, and commentary on them, the explanations on them. Well, it's life changing.
You know, it's funny you say that because for a couple of years I've been printing everything to stay ahead of, so I could read a little bit and take notes on the side of the thing rather than extra legal pads, which I do kind of both. But I've clipped them and I have them in a folder, or I have them in some boxes. And I keep looking through them, and I say, well, you know, I should throw these away. We've got the books now. I'm just reading them out of the books.
Right.
But every time I pick up one, I start reading it, and I go, wow, that's really good.
It's really good. I can't now I start reading it. It's really good.
No, I say, wait a minute. I got to study on this stuff for next week, and I'm, you know, for next Friday, and I'm going, well, I'm going to take an hour or so, and I just, you know, read that for a while.
And for a lot of things, we're not bragging. We're simply translating Yahweh's testimony and sharing it and commenting on it. It's Yahweh's testimony, and it is really good.
Yeah.
Oh, and I'm so our world changed tremendously. Not only when Jackie took over the publishing, so that these books all have now a common theme, a common look, and that they're set. Even the font, the margins, and the font and the presentation is so enormously credible and more easily processed and read inside. With this, all this very similar look. It's an elegant look, but also what David has done in reshaping the website and keeping it current, and having all those books available and having the ability to read these books for free in their entirety on a computer screen or on a laptop or on a tablet or on your smartphone. They read beautifully on a smartphone. And the very fact that they're current, it's just so pleased with where we are. And quite honestly, Dad's pleased too.
Wow, even better. Wow.
That is, we're in a very, very happy place, and we're just going to continue to give it our best effort between now and the time that we're called home, and it's our honor to do so. And we hope that many of you come to join us. We're asking nothing of you. We do not solicit and will not accept donations. There is no organization, there's no leadership, there's no oath of allegiance, there's nothing here, but God's testimony is accurately presented as we can, available to you at no charge and no royalty. It's just our pleasure to invite you into God's company. We love Him. We enjoy His company, and we want to share it even more than that. God made a promise to reconcile His relationship with His people, Yisrael and Yahudah. He intends to do so, and God never works alone. So He always finds someone, and sometimes it's someone's, to engage through to achieve His purposes. And for whatever reason, He chose us, and we're committed to doing the best job we can possibly do, to not letting our God down. We want Dad to be pleased.
Yes,
and that
sir.
For us. And that, along with the fact that we will know two things. Not only is Dad pleased, but the family will be enhanced by additional members as a result of what we've been able to accomplish together. And those who opt to be antagonists, to continue to fight against God, all of them, whether they be Christians and questioning Paul, Muslims and prophet of doom, or religious Jews in the Introduction to God or Moed Mikre volumes, they will all be left without excuse. And I think God wants it that way.
Mm-hmm.
And so we continue to do what we can, serving our dad on your behalf. So may Yah bless. Happy Shabbat to one and all. We look forward to being with you this time next week. May Yah bless you all.
Bye, Shalom. Yes. Night.